Morning, church family. Welcome to Arbor Christian Fellowship on this lovely Sunday. I have a few announcements for you. A lot of them are in the bulletin already, but a couple of highlights I want to hit. Our church workday next weekend, next Saturday at 9 a.m. We're going to spruce this place up and get ready for Easter. And Greg's going to organize it and get us all assigned out, and then we're going to go ahead and do that between 9 and noon. Secondly is our Easter egg hunt on the day before Easter, on the 30th, I believe the day that is. Yeah. And I still need volunteers. I noticed there's a lot of gaps on the sign-up sheets, so I added mine today. I forgot to. But yeah, it's always fun reaching out to the community and seeing all the kids come in and engaging with the parents. So we're really looking forward to that. Food banks rolling along. ESL, same thing. Always need volunteers to work with those ministries. Dr. Awa was supposed to be here this weekend, and he got his visa, all the okays to go from the government, but they would not fund him, so he is not here today. So I'm very disappointed. It's always great when Dr. Awa comes from Cameroon and shares what's going on with the school there, the Christ the Messiah school in Cameroon. Continues to grow, I'm sure, and it's just a dangerous spot, and you know, in government's wisdom, one hand's giving you the okay, the other hand's not giving you the money, but he'll get here, and just keep praying for him and his ministry. And then lastly, there was a graduation this week. You say, John, it's only St. Patrick's Day. Well, we had one graduate this week. Miss Beverly Dale went home to be with the Lord this Wednesday. And, you know, she's such a sweet, sweet lady. I got the pleasure of being her deacon after Ray Jones. And she gave me, she goes, you have a lot of lot to live up to. Deacon Ray Jones was very, very precious to me. I said, well, I can only do what John Patterson can do, but I will try and do my best. And, you know, Miss Beverly, she didn't mind telling you when, you know, she didn't like something, or she encouraged you and prayed for you. And I enjoyed serving with her on the pastor search committee, because I was the chairman, and I asked her one day if she would consider that, and she was just kind of taken aback. She goes, well, I've never served on a search committee or in a committee of this importance. And I said, well, pray about it. And, you know, I kind of gave her some of the ideas and the things she would have to do. She goes, well, I don't know about my health, but I knew she would go home and she would really pray about it. It just wasn't to blow me off, say, oh, I'll pray about it, and then not pray about it. So, and she did. She was very faithful, you know, even though she was battling some medical issues with her blood sugar and a little bit of vertigo. But she was there. I can't even remember her missing in a year and a half. They're prepared, they're on time, sharing and contributing, and that was a real blessing to our committee, you know, throughout that time. So, you know, I rejoice that Miss Beverly is graduated, and you know, I'm a visual person, I'm a right brain person, so I kind of visualize her getting that mansion that has been promised in heaven, and I just picture hers as, you know, like from Dallas, South Fork, you know, you have that big ranch and all the green grass. I picture that's hers, because she was from Texas, and she's a very elegant lady. So that's my picture of Beverly getting her mansion in heaven. So I just want to just bring that to you. Okay, let's pray. Father God, we just thank you for this time. We can come together, hear your word, apply it to our lives. We know that you can give us the boldness to go out and reach people for the community. We just thank you for those that are here and just those that are traveling during business or pleasure. Just bring them back home safe to us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. This is the time in the program that Vic comes up and does a children's message. That's Vic's thing. So I'm not going to take Vic's spot. I just want to pray for the kids, if that's okay. When I was... a father of my four children when they were young. Every night when they go to sleep, I would pray over each one. I try to do it every night, but I prayed over my children almost every single night while they're sleeping. And I also pray for my wife, too, while she's sleeping. So I believe firmly in the power of prayer over children. And so let's pray for them as we pray for them and what kind of world that they're going to be living in. And you join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the children of this church. We are thankful, Father, because you said that there were blessings to us as parents. And we thank you, Lord, for the joy of being their responsibility. And you have given them over to us, Lord, to watch over them and to lead them to you the best that we can. And Father, we just continue to pray for their safety and their health. We pray, Father, that they are ingrained with God's word, even in a young age, and they learn how to implement it in their lives. And Father, we just pray for the parents, that Father, they teach well, and the teaching of the gospel and the Lord Jesus Christ and God's word begins in the home. And so I pray for the parents, Lord, to pray over them and govern over them and watch over them and teach them the ways of the Lord. And we thank you, Father, for them in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, I want to add just one more announcement about what's going on Wednesday night. You, of course, know Awana, and we've talked about the Immerse Messiah Bible Reading Club that we started for Awana parents. Many of the, in fact, I think all of the parents that are coming are parents of children in Awana, but they are attending other churches, almost all of them, Wednesday night. We had yet one more. So I say two things to those of you who are parents, and you're just hanging out at that time, we're having a good time talking about the Bible. And if you want to be a part of that, see me. But other than that, it's just been very exciting to see how God is blessing that. And it's a challenge, let me tell you, to talk of. This week, our discussion, the parts that we read were from 2 Corinthians, Galatians, and the first part of Romans. Well, that's a lot of stuff to get together and talk about what it means to you. But it's not a Bible study, as we just discuss what we read during the week. So it's going very well, and I'm very excited about that. God is faithful. When we pray for these children or any other things, we recognize that God remains faithful to us in honoring our prayers. Let's sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided." Seek ye first the kingdom of God. When you look up songs like Holy, Holy, there's number of songs that say holy, comma, holy, and holy, holy, and holy, 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 and there's about 10 on that list. You always have to be sure you get the right one, and when you do, it'll have a lot of different words than some other song that you might be familiar with. But let's sing it. It goes like this: holy, holy. Second verse is gracious Father. Third verse is precious Jesus. The fourth verse is Holy Spirit, and then finally, Alleluia for the fifth verse. Very short, but beautiful words. It makes us think about the holiness of God and our relationship to him in that.
Amen.
John DiGiudice, please.
Amen. Thank you, Greg, for that worship. And if you are able, can you please rise as I read God's word. In preparation for Resurrection Sunday and Easter, I wanted to start off this day with talking about who Christ is. And the title of the message is Setting the Captives Free. This is found in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 to 19. And the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. This is Christ reading Isaiah chapter 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he appointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. You may be seated. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And we thank you, Father, as we look forward to Resurrection Sunday and the cross where you gave your life for us. In preparation for that, Lord, we are so thankful that you were sent because we were held captive. We were blind and we were oppressed and we were so poor in spirit. And Father, we needed a Savior. And so we thank you, Father, for this wonderful gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So last week, this message is like a continuation from last week. And last week, we talked about the lies of the ungodly. And we're going over Romans chapter 1, verses 16 to 25. And we unveiled four main lies of the world that govern all the rest of the lies that is portrayed in this world. Number one, there is no God. Number two, God is not the creator. Number three, the creature is greater than the creator. And God's way is not the right way. Our way is the right way. And our worship of ourselves is the right way. And those four lies is the foundation of the lies of this world. If you look at in the world today, the way the world is, it's because of these four lies that they believe. There is no God, there is no creator, no king, and so our way is the best way, and God's way is not the best way, and we do our own thing. We no longer worship God, we worship ourselves, and we indulge in whatever our flesh desires. And that's why God gave them over to the depravity of their hearts. And that is the condition of the world. And the main thing I want to talk about today is the exchange and how they exchange the image of the incorruptible God for the corruptible man and to the four-footed beast, and how they worship man and they worship beast instead of the Almighty God, and they did that exchange. And instead of having the image of God, the Almighty God, they chose to have the image of man who was sinful and the beasts who were created. It's funny how the world, they worship animals, cows, snakes, birds, just whatever you could think of. The Roman Empire, they worship animals, and that's who Paul was addressing. And here, they're saying that God is not there, and so we rule ourselves, and we'd rather worship man versus worship our creator. And so that exchange, I want to focus on that today. That exchange altered and diluted our identity. In this world today, the word identity is being pushed so much. It's like the main thing that people talk about now is identity. And that's one thing that they got right. Because identity is the most important thing about you. And Satan knows that. And so Satan wants this world to focus on their identity. But it's earthly. And so that exchange altered or marred their identity in Christ. So why is identity important? Why is identity important? Because with identity, you don't have a firm grasp of who you are. Your existence, your understanding about yourself. You don't have the foundation, if you don't know who you are, to establish your own beliefs, your values, and how to deal with your experiences in life if you don't have a firm identity of who you are. Based on our identity, we have purpose in our life. Our identity governs the way we live. Our identity governs the way we think. Our identity governs how we treat people. So identity is so important to the world, to the unbeliever, and also to the believer. Your identity will govern your way of life. And so I wanted to talk about that today because if Christians lack their identity in Christ, then their mission is altered as well. Their purpose in living is not the right way. So in counseling, one of the things I do, if I've never met the person before, I spend like 2 days, two sessions, or maybe three, just trying to figure out their identity and what they think about themselves and how they think about the world. Because the Bible says, a fool gives an answer before he knows the whole thing. And so before I counsel somebody, I need to know as much as I can about that person before I can tell them God's truth. And so many times I ask this, the counselee, so who are you? Tell me a little bit about yourself. You know what they say mostly? Well, what do you want to know? If you go to an interview for a job and they asked you, so tell me a little bit about yourself, the worst response is, well, what do you want to know? That tells the interviewer, you have no grasp of who you are. You have no understanding of who you are. And I read one time in a job interview when they asked that question, they want to know this one thing, who you are and how who you are will help us as a business. That's what they want to hear. I am this, and this will help your business. And this will be a benefit to your business if you hire me. So that's what they want to hear, not, well, what do you want to know about me? And so I found out, man, people really don't have a firm grasp of who they are, especially who they are as a Christian. And their life shows it. And the thing is, this issue of identity, again, Satan wants to confuse everything. Satan wants to have people ignorant about who they are. It's his scheme, it's his desire, it's his deception. And so when you have a false identity of who you are, life will show it. So if you ask an unbeliever who they are, their understanding of who they are is earthly. Remember they exchanged? They don't have a heavenly understanding of spiritual who they are. It's only earthly. And so this is what they would say. My gender is my identity. My social class, my age, my education, my sexual orientation, that's my identity. But in Christ Jesus, though, our identity is not physical. It's spiritual. It's spiritual. And that's what I hope to encourage you all today, that your identity is not earthly. Identity is not earthly. It is heavenly. Because if you have identity here on the earth, you're going to live for the earth. And you're going to live things for the earth. But if you have a spiritual heavenly identity, you're going to live for heaven. You're going to live for the Lord. You're going to live for heavenly and spiritual things versus the things here on this earth that's going to burn. and it's going to be destroyed, and the Bible says it's going to fade away. So, counselees, when I talk to them, I want to see who they are in Christ Jesus. And here's the thing, though. Even if someone has been in church for a long time, like 20, 30 years, they still don't know who they are in Christ Jesus. I've come to find that out. That just because they're sitting in the pews and they go to all these services and they do all these church events, they have no grasp of who they are in Christ Jesus. They're just doing a lot of activities. But the deep understanding of what Christ has done for them, the knowledge of the goodness of God and the Creator and our purpose here, they don't have a firm grasp of who they are. When I talk to someone, my first job as a biblical counselor is to find out first if they're a believer. Because if they're not a believer yet, the Bible is not going to work for them, right? It's not going to, they have some good truths, but for the Bible to work for them, they must be a believer and know God and know Christ as their Savior. So my first job is to know where they are in their faith. And so if they don't know God, they don't know Christ, then that's my first job, is to introduce them to Christ and the gospel. And so, for example, this one girl who's been in church for 20 years since she was a baby. Since she was a baby, she was in church for 20 years, and now she's like 23, 24, 25. And I asked her, so if you were gonna die today, and you were gonna go to heaven, and there was a gate there, and they said, why should we let you in? And the angel's there saying, why should we let you into heaven? What would you say to this angel? What would you say to this angel? Why would you be permitted to go into heaven? 8 or 9 times out of 10, the answer is this: because I'm a good person. That's my experience, and I think that is the common thing, because I'm a good person. And we start from there. This gospel must be shared. She must understand who Christ is and accept him as a Lord and personal Savior, and then biblical counseling can begin. And so, who is God to you? Who is Christ Jesus to you? What is your identity in Christ? Can you give a firm explanation about that? Can you give a firm explanation about that? How do you know, if you were a teacher, how would you know someone understood what you were teaching? How would you know? They would be able to say back what you taught, right? They have an understanding. If you asked the common believer, why are you saved? They wouldn't have a clear answer. So who are you in Christ? Who am I in Christ Jesus? And that's the reason why he came to die on the cross for our sins. This passage in Luke chapter 4, verse 18 to 19, it tells me who we are without Christ. This is our identity without Christ. So if you have your Bibles, it's not working today, so we have to go old school and go in your own Bible. I love the Bible. But by the way, I love that you're bringing your Bible instead of the electronic one. I think we should bring back the Bible. You think so? We should bring back the Bible. That's just me. That's just me. I like the Bible. And because my kids are back there on their phone, I say, hey, get off your phone. Dad, I'm on the Bible. Yeah, sure, right? You know, it's like, you know, I like to bring back the Bible. And so remember when I was going to church in the 80s, I know it's a long time ago, when I was a little kid in the 80s, man, people brought their Bibles to church. But I know today we advanced and now the Bible's in our electronics, so I get it. But it would be nice if the Bible would be brought back. Okay, the passage here, Luke chapter 4, 18 and 19, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery to the sight of the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. Luke 4:18-19. So this is Jesus talking, and Jesus had a clear understanding of who he was and what he came to do. Number one, he said, the Spirit appointed me. There was no confusion about that, that the Spirit appointed him. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me, number one, to preach the gospel to the poor. That means he came to share the gospel to the spiritually poor. Number two, he came to proclaim release of the captives. Number three, to recover the sight of the blind. Number four, to set free those who are oppressed. And number five, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. That is a clear understanding of who he was. And Christ had that firm understanding. This is who I am. I am anointed by the Holy Spirit. I am appointed by God. And these are the things that I am here to do: to preach the gospel to the poor, to proclaim freedom of the captives, to recover the sight of the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. And this mission of God tells me my identity without Christ. It tells me who I am. And this is what I go over in talking to people. I want them to have a firm understanding who they are without God and without Christ. Number one, I am poor in spirit. That's my identity. I'm poor. It doesn't matter how much money I have, how much wealth I have. I have all these things. It doesn't matter if I'm poor or whatever. It doesn't matter about my physical condition. I am poor without Christ. That is my condition. That is my identity. Number two, it says here that I am held captive. I am held captive under sin, and I am in prison, and that is who I am. I am held captive. I am sentenced to death, both physically and spiritually, and I am sentenced to live in that condition. Number three, I am oppressed by sin. That's who I am. I am under the evil rule of sin, and I cannot get under it, the penalty of sin. I can't pay the penalty of that sin. It is oppression, and it is a burden to me, and I can't get rid of it. And that's who I am. That's my identity. And that's why I need a Savior. And then it says here, D, I am spiritually ignorant of Christ. I am spiritually ignorant of Christ Jesus. And that is my identity. That is who I am. That's the truth about who we are without God and without Christ. He came to set all those things free and to resolve all those issues in our life. I wonder how much for the Lord Jesus Christ, God to send his son to die on the cross for our sins and to go through all that punishment. Man, this world must be really messed up. And he must really love us so much that he didn't want us to live in this kind of world. He wanted to redeem us and save us. So for him to go that far, man, he must love us so much, because he didn't want us to live in that condition apart from him. And so he was willing to send his son to die on the cross for us. For us, his enemies. He came to die for the rapists, he came to die for the murderers, he came to die for the liars, the thieves, the gossipers, he came to die for adulterers, he came to die for all of us. Imagine how much pain and suffering he must have had to endure to pay for all that sin. Sometimes it blows my mind when I think about it, how much sin is in the world, and Jesus came to die for all of that sin. It blows my mind. Sometimes I say, like Noah, Jonah, when God told Jonah to go and preach the gospel or to warn the people of Nineveh, and Jonah just said, they are evil people, just kill them. Just destroy them. I'm so surprised God just doesn't destroy us, you know, because we're so evil in this world, but I can't understand God's love to send his one and only son to die on the cross for me. And I shared this before. I understood the love of God when I had my first son. I had the love of the Father implanted in me. And I could express, I could feel how God must love unconditionally. And whatever my son did, whatever my son, his behavior or what he chose to do and whatever, it doesn't remove that unconditional love for them. God loves me so much that he gave up his only one and son. And this blows my mind that I, like I said before to you all, I would not give up any of my kids for you. I would not give up. Would you give up your kids for me to die on the cross for me or to die for my penalty or to be put in jail for me? Maybe. Okay. But I'm saying this blows my mind about the loving God that we serve, that he loved us so much that he would be willing to die on the cross for us and send his son. And that's what I fear the most, that believers have lost the gravity of God's love. It's not even part of their thinking anymore. They take it for granted about what God has done for us. And Easter becomes just a celebration that we just do. But here's the thing. Easter should be every day of our life. What Christ did for us should govern every single day of our life. We should say every morning, thank you, Christ, for the cross. Every single morning. You give gratitude to Christ every single morning for what he did. And I guarantee if you do that, it will govern your life. But many times we just lose sight because we're so busy. We have the world to do. We have responsibility. We have this and that. And we lose sight of the gravity of what Christ has done for us. Without Christ, that is our identity. We're poor. We're captive. We're blind. We're oppressed. And we are ignorant of spiritual things. But when Christ came to die on the cross for us, he says, I have come to remove all that. This passage in Luke chapter 4, 18 to 19, this is Christ's battle cry. This is Christ's battle cry. I am here, and this is what I'm called to do. It is a battle cry. But after Christ, when you come to know Christ and you understand the power of the cross, the power of his resurrection, the power of salvation, everything changes. Everything changes. You are no longer poor in spirit, but you are rich. You are rich. Not only rich, you are wealthy. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, 1, he has opened up the windows of heaven and all the spiritual blessings he pours down onto us abundantly. We are not just rich, but we are wealthy. I figured out there's a difference between being rich and being wealthy. Rich means you have money, a lot of money, but you still have to work. Wealthy means that you have a lot of money and the money works for you and you don't have to work anymore. Rich and wealthy. But in Christ Jesus, you are no longer poor. In spirit, you are wealthy. It's given all to you in the spiritual sense of who Christ is. You are no longer poor. Number two, or the next thing, is you are no longer a captive of sin, but he has released you from the burden of sin. He has released you, that sin no longer has dominion over you. He has freed you from the bondage of sin, and you could live a life of holiness and righteousness that is pleasing to him. I tell this to people who are, they say they're like addicted. If they say they're a believer and they know Christ and they think that they can't break addictions, and if they can't, if they lose hope that what they're dealing with can't be solved and they can't overcome it, and there's a sin in their life, I have to remind them, if they are in Christ Jesus, that sin has no dominion over you. He has broken the bondage of sin, and you are set free. So open up your heart and your mind to the power of Christ Jesus in your life, because you are actually set free. You have a wrong opinion about yourself, that it's because of your strength and your power that you are losing, and you are right. But you need to change that. It's the power of Christ in you that will change you and govern you, your life, and cause you to live in holiness and righteousness. So as a believer, our identity no longer is captive. We are no longer prisoners. We are free. We are set free. Another thing that we are, instead of we are oppressed or blind, it says here that before Christ, we were spiritually blind. We couldn't see. But now in Christ, we got some new glasses. We got some new vision. And now we not only see the physical, we're able now to see the spiritual things of God. We have a different view of life, a different perspective of who Christ is, and now we can see. We're able to see. I'm growing old, and my vision is going away, and sometimes things get blurry. I can't see, right? And I'm a danger if I'm driving. I can't read. And what do? I put some reading glasses on. Oh, I can see now. I can see clearly. I can see. And that's what the believer, unbelievers are. Man, without Christ Jesus, they can't see spiritual things. They can't understand spiritual things. And so I don't have anger for them in the way they live. I have more compassion for them. Because, man, imagine living blind in this world and not being able to see clearly. That is a terrible state to be living in. But for us, we can see clearly. We can see the deceptions of Satan, his schemes, all of that. We can see with the power of the Holy Spirit the spiritual things of this world now. And it says here we are also oppressed. We are no longer oppressed. But again, we are set free from the oppression of sin in our lives. And we are more than conquerors in our lives. And that is our identity. And it says in the last one, it says here that Christ came to proclaim the year of the Lord. Right? He came to declare to people who he is and who Christ is and the gospel. And which means he came to destroy ignorance. He came to destroy ignorance. So in Christ Jesus, we are no longer ignorant of spiritual things. We understand God's word, God's truth. We have it in our possession. And when we read it, we are no longer ignorant of who he is. And man, Satan loves it when people are ignorant. When I call you ignorant, people think that's a bad thing. But it's not really that bad. Because ignorance can be solved. Just give you more information, give you the truth. And now, if you're foolish and people call you stupid, then that's another thing, right? That can't be easily solved. But ignorance can be solved by just truth. And because now that we have Christ Jesus in our life, we are a whole different person. Remember Paul? Paul had a clear understanding who he was. Before Christ, he was a murderer. He was a legalist. He hated the church. And he destroyed anything that came with the name of Christ. The Christians back in the New Testament, they were called people of the way. They weren't called Christians at first. They were called people of the way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So they were called people of the way. And Paul destroyed anyone who had that title. If you were a people of the way, you were Paul's target. And that was his identity. But then when he encountered Christ, everything changed. He said he was a bondservant of Christ, a slave, a servant. Everything changed. His identity all changed. And that's who he was. He never referred to back when he was before Christ. He never referred to him back then. Oh, he always referred to himself as now in Christ Jesus. And there's this phrase, and I've come to appreciate this phrase for a long time. I've heard it since I was young. But now I kind of disagree with the phrase. And here's the phrase. Now I gotta forget the phrase. I am a sinner saved by grace. I don't think that's a true statement anymore. Because that phrase, you're still identifying yourself as a sinner. I am a sinner saved by grace. It should be turned around. I am saved by grace, but I sin sometimes. I identify as Christ that saved me. I am no longer that sinner. I don't identify as that sinner before. I identify as a changed person in Christ. So when someone says to me, "What's your faith?" "Oh, I'm a sinner saved by grace." You're still identifying as a sinner. I know some of you may disagree with me, but this is just my thoughts about that. That someone who says they believe in Christ Jesus, they still identify as that sinner. Paul never did that. Paul never did that. He always identified himself as this changed person. I am no longer that sinner. I have been set free. I am no longer identified. I proclaim that I have been changed. And I have been released from that. So why am I identifying myself still as a sinner? I am saved by grace, but sin is just still a part of my life because I'm human, but I don't identify as that sinner. I have been changed. Because here's some verses, and I'll close with these verses. This is some verses that talk about how we are transformed. And our identity is transformed as no longer sinners if you believe in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation." He was a sinner, and now he's a new creation. So why is this new creation still identifying as that sinner? "He is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come." If any was in Christ, he is a new creature. "The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come." Galatians chapter 3:28 says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. You're all one in Christ Jesus." This passage is saying there's no one greater than the other. We're all equal. There's no Jew or no Greek. Like, if you're a Jew, you're not better than a Greek. That's not your identity. That's what makes who you are in Christ Jesus. We're all equal. There's slave or free. If you're a slave and you're free, you're still the same. There's no difference. It doesn't make one better than the other. Male or female, they're all the same. They're equal in our God's eyes, in Christ Jesus. Galatians 2, verse 20, it says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ that lives in me. In the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. So here Paul is saying, that old Paul has been crucified with Christ. All my sins and who I was nailed to the cross. I don't identify with that old Paul. It says, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And if Christ that lives in me, Christ is not a sinner. So if Christ is living within me, I'm not going to identify as a sinner. I may sin, like I said, and I might do wrong things, but I don't identify as that. But Christ who lives in me, and the life that I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. And here's the last verse. 1 Peter chapter 2, 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You were once a people of darkness, and now you are a people of light. You now identify with light, not with darkness. And that's what I hope to share with you today. It says that if you know Christ Jesus, that is your identity. It's not how much money you make. It's not what kind of career you had. Not your family. Not your social standing. Not your anything. Your identity is in Christ Jesus, what Christ has done for you. And that is the basis of who you are. It says here in that passage, you are a chosen generation, you are a royal priesthood, you are a holy nation. The people I talk to, their mind and their heart are so, they're in the gutter. They're in the mud. The way they're living their life, they're in the mud. I'm saying to myself, if you know Christ Jesus, Christ has more for you. Do you hear this passage? He says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. I tell people that, and they're in the mud, and I tell them, get out of the mud. Stop thinking low. I tell people, you have much more to offer than this because you are a chosen person of Christ. Get out of the mud. And it says in this last passage, so that you may proclaim the praises who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Christ has done all that. He saved you. He came came down to die on the cross for you and to resurrect. He did all that to save you, to redeem you, to make you his holy people, not just for yourself, and not just keep it for yourself. The purpose of all that, the chosen people, the royal priesthood, and the special people of God, the main purpose for doing that is so that you can proclaim. You may proclaim the praises of Christ to the world. To proclaim. The word proclaim means to shout, to declare to the world of what Christ has done. One of the good illustrations of that I share with some young people. You remember Paul Revere? The guy who declared and rode into the city telling people, the British are coming. The British are coming. And through that, so many people were saved. So many people were able to prepare. So many people were able to get out. And they were able to get ready, and there was this big battle, but the people were ready. There was no surprise. There was no attack. And so we are like Paul Revere's. We're here to declare and proclaim the goodness of the Lord, to declare to this world that is lost, who is blind, who is oppressed, who is ignorant of who Christ is. We are here to proclaim it. Remember how we identify with Christ, Jesus? And now, so then that means that what Christ did, now we need to do. Remember in the passage? Remember the passage? In Luke chapter 4, 18 to 19, we are called now to proclaim the gospel to the spiritually poor. That's what we're called to do. We are called to proclaim the release of those who are in spiritual bondage and captivity. We are called to restore spiritual sight to the blind. We are called to proclaim and set free those who are oppressed of sin. And we are called to proclaim the Lord is here to those who are ignorant of who Christ is. That's why we're here. That's why the church is here. That's why I'm not concerned about building a big church with a lot of people. I'm not concerned about that. Because you can have a big church, but people are just lost just as anybody. There's lost people in these big churches. So I'm not looking to grow a big church. What I'm looking for is to see people know the Lord. One by one, know the Lord. And this is where you guys can come in, is where you can proclaim the good news of the Lord. You can invite people to church. You can invite people to activities. When you have activities here in this church and people come from outside, as a people, you need this mission in your heart. There are some lost people coming here. There are some spiritually blind people coming here. There are some spiritually oppressed people coming here. And there are some ignorant people who don't know Christ coming here. And so as a church body, you're not just throwing an event as a tradition. Oh, we do this every year, so we're going to do it every year. But this church has to transform its identity from a church that is so passionate about the lost people that it transforms your heart. The church will not change unless the people change. You can't do the same thing and expect a different result. So my job is not to change the church, the programs. My hope is to change the hearts of the people. That's where it starts. And it starts with your identity. And who is Christ to you? And if that is your identity, then your job is to proclaim the good news as Christ did. And let's call it Easter is the third most attended service. The third most attended service of the year. You know what's number one? Christmas. But the Bible never said to remember Christmas. The Bible never said to remember Christmas. But it is a part of the purpose. But Jesus never said, you know what? I need you to celebrate my birth. Never said that. The only thing that Jesus said was to celebrate my death, to remember my death. Because without my death and my resurrection, my birth means nothing. But yet, we celebrate Christmas more than Easter. We plan for Christmas more than Easter. Just look at Easter this year. During Christmas, you guys were all into Christmas a month in advance. Choirs, this and that. But for Easter, the world, there's no noise about it. There's no noise, except for that one day. Then there's noise. But Jesus never said to remember my birth. He said, remember my death and celebrate it with the Lord's Supper. I want you to remember and celebrate it. So the first, number one, is Christmas. You know what the number two most attended service is? Huh? Thanksgiving, nope. Mother's Day. Mother's Day is the second most attended service of the year. And then it's Easter. Easter, where they come back and stuff. So church, we need to change stuff around. It starts with you and what Christ means to you. And this world is going to make focus on identity because that's really important to them. But they identify with the things of the world that's earthly. Let them do it. That's the world that's going to do. Let them do it. You just pray for them. They're going to do what they're going to do. But the judgment of God begins in the house of the Lord. It doesn't begin out there. It begins with the Lord, the house. So let's consider who we are in Christ Jesus and have that passion and pray, Christ Jesus, give me your same passion for the lost people in this world. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We just thank you, Father, for the Lord Jesus Christ. And based on this passage, Lord, he has come to bring the gospel to the spiritually poor, to proclaim freedom and release of captivity and the prison of sin and of Satan. You have come, Lord, to restore the spiritual sight of those who are spiritually blind. And you have come, Lord, to set the captives free and to set the people oppressed and release them from that sin and the oppression of it. And you have come, Lord, to destroy just the ignorance of the world, of who Christ is, to proclaim who you are. And so, Father, as your people and those of us who carry your identity, and this is who we are, help us, Father, to have that same passion and that same love for people and that same love to restore and save the souls of those who need saving. Bless these people, Father. Give them a passion for you and for the cross that no one else can give them. It doesn't matter how much I preach up here. It doesn't matter how much sermons that they hear. Father, it is the power of the Holy Spirit that will touch their hearts and their minds, Lord, and just transform them and change them into the people that you want us to be as your special people who will proclaim the goodness of God, of our Lord Jesus Christ. We just thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We'll rise up and sing a song as we close, and I'll call Greg up. And if you want to come to know the Lord, if the Lord has not been your Savior, I'll be here, and I want to share Christ with you and make sure you have this identity in Christ firmly in your heart.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am and waiting to thee whose blood I pray.
God is in you all.
The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory.
Like a flood.
The battle belongs to the Lord.
Let's raise up a standard, the power.